You can say what you wanna say, be who you wanna be, come speak your mind, be you. Get ready for the naked truth. Dr. Kelly bringing it to you right on time.
No half stepping.
She's bringing you the naked truth.
That's right. I'm bringing you the naked truth. I am so excited about our show tonight because there's so many things going on in the media that leads us to believe that we need a lesson in conflict resolution. Wow. Really. So, of course, to help us do that, I have my wonderful team with me. We have Miss Charity Watts,
hello.
Representing Team Rock, and we have Mr. Anthony Washington
in the house.
And then we have you are in the house, aren't you? Wow. And then we have our resident expert who's written several books and been in several reality shows. He is a man with a plan. He is my mother.
I think the cycle has officially ended.
He is my brother from another mother who is. That's good.
Unless like he's that, making Charity? A Bruce Jenner okay. announcement.
Yeah.
Hassani,
I would hope we would not be promoting that. I would hope we would not be promoting that.
Hassani, are you on the line?
I'm here.
Good. You know, he's my mother from another brother. That just does not work. Anyway, we're very excited about our show tonight because, of course, any time that we have our show on The Naked Truth, our whole goal is to make sure that you get the truth, that you're exposed to wisdom, and that you grow in some shape, form, or fashion. So we realized that in recent days, there have been a lot of police brutality, a lot of racism that we thought, had gone to sleep and has woken up like the giant that it had been years ago. And we felt that it was very important to do a show on conflict resolution. And that could be within community relations, within your family situation, within marriages, within business relationships. So we think that it would be apropos to do it in totality for all those different reasons. So Hassani, we want to just start this conversation off with the one case that really made us think we really needed to bring up this topic. And that's the case of Sandra Bland. Okay, this is a woman, most people know, in Texas, was driving in her car and the police was behind her. There's a notion that when she saw the police behind her, she was attempting to try to move over to let the police pass, but in essence, she didn't use her blinker. So then the police pulled her over for not using the blinker. And if you watch the video, it escalates from there because he ends up trying to pull her out of the car. He tells her to, stop smoking her cigarette. She's getting agitated because she's like, I just was moving over to let you through, and now you're harassing me. He ended up pulling her out, and then off the camera, you hear that there's this scuffle between the two of them, which he alleges that she assaulted him. He arrested her. She was in jail for 3 days, and within those 3 days, she allegedly committed suicide. Is this wild?
It's worse. It's worse than wild. But you know what? Before I even specifically address the details of this particular case,
yes,
I think it's important that we have a clear understanding of the background on who this woman is. I don't know how many of you are aware, but this is a woman who, for some time now on social media, has really had a voice in terms of encouraging people to take to the streets and to have cameras and video and record interactions with the police so that we can raise the awareness of police brutality, particularly on black men, but now we see even black women.
Right.
And she had been doing this for quite some time. And really, there has been a windstorm of videos that have been circulating all throughout Facebook. So knowing that, we know that when it comes to Facebook, when it comes to Twitter, when it comes to Google in general, they work with the CIA, with the FBI, local police, and any time there have been incidences or individuals that have been perceived as rabble-rousers, they have come in and have arrested. So I don't believe that this incident is just some a random traffic stop that resulted in her arrest, which ultimately resulted in her death. There have been cases before. In fact, there was a rapper who actually created a song talking about police brutality. And at the end of the video, he got killed by the police in the video. Well, several days later, after this video went viral, he actually got killed by the police. And so I'm just saying that it is not an accident. It is not a random incident. I believe that there's a bigger story behind the story that's being told.
Yes, and you know, and I'm sure it's a bigger story. And it's, I mean, it's quite bizarre that, you know, you can be for 1 minute pulled over for a traffic violation and then end up dead. A lot of people don't believe that she committed suicide. They actually believe that there was some type of, repercussions for her, the way she interacted with the cops. So they're doing an investigation, and we'll stay tuned for those results. So the question I have for you is, since we're talking about conflict resolution, and I want Team Rock to chime in, is that do you think that based on the video, which we all have seen the video some shape, form, or fashion, do you think that she could have handled herself in a different way in order to have a different result, and then the result being still being alive?
Well, it depends. I mean, if we're going back to what Hassani was saying, that there's a story behind the story, then maybe not. Maybe no matter how she acted, if it was, you know, for a particular reason, that we a hidden agenda behind that. I mean, most times, you know, they aren't going to pull you over and give you that much trouble over a blinker. Like I don't even think they pull people over for a blinker. I mean, I've never seen it. So if they're going to really cause that much ruckus, I mean, I kind of agree with this, Sonya. Maybe more to that. So the outcome, you know, may have looked differently, but I think the outcome might have been the same if there was a hidden agenda behind it. But that's with any conflict, though. I think no matter how the other person on the receiving end reacts, if it's an agenda behind the person initiating the conflict, chances are something is going to transpire.
That's a good point. That's a very good point. Anthony?
In part of the video, you see that the officer, part of what caused it to escalate was the officer had asked her to put out her cigarette. She was smoking in her car, and she was like, why? You know, I don't have to put out my cigarette. Just write the ticket, write this BS ticket that you're about to give me for no blinker. And the only reason I moved over because I felt like you were tailgating me. So I think she could have said, I'll put out the cigarette. Okay, boom, I put out the cigarette. Because it seemed to escalate from that point on. So I don't know if the officer felt threatened. I'm thinking if I was an officer, maybe I don't have a legal right to ask her to put out the cigarette, but I know if he doesn't know who he's pulling over, a cigarette is lit. You can use it as a weapon, in a sense, if you know somebody can get burned from it. So I could see him asking to do that. She might have a right to say, I don't have to put it out, I'm in my car, but I don't know. You know, if she had put it out, maybe the situation would have been a little different. I'm not blaming her. This is not me blaming her at all, because he was definitely in the wrong. But I'm just saying, our thing is conflict resolution, management and resolutions.
Okay, so Hassani, what do you think? What do you think?
Wow. Well, I think that, unfortunately, too many of us romanticize our people. So as I'm watching the news and pundits, you have two sides. Those that are in favor of the police, he did no wrong, she did everything wrong. Those are in favor of the woman, she did no wrong, the police did wrong. I think we need to stop romanticizing. The reality is it could have possibly turned out differently if there was no other agenda attached.
Right.
Listen, at some point we have to use common sense. Common sense and preemptive action can diffuse conflicts before they even get out of hand. And so obviously she had an attitude. Obviously she was talking to the police officer probably in a way that she shouldn't have been speaking to him. At the end of the day, he's got a gun and a badge. He represents the law, and many of them think that they're above the law. So positionally, she's operating from a position of weakness. So to get all big and bad and to challenge him the way that she did, I think probably added to the situation. Now, obviously, I believe that the police officer, it wasn't even about a law being broken, because what law did she break smoking a cigarette? I think it's the issue of power. And a lot of police officers have this complex, right? They have this power thing that they go that they operate from. So no matter what I say, it's your job to submit. And if you don't, then you're breaking the law and I'm taking you down. And it's just a ridiculous scenario. it could have been played out so many different type of ways. I think they both contributed to the problem.
Right. And so when you deal with somebody in a power situation where someone clearly has the power and you don't, and you feel like you feel powerless, how do you handle yourself to where at least you maintain your dignity? Because maybe that's what she was struggling for, is, you know what, I haven't done anything wrong. I'm a citizen. I can smoke a cigarette. You're clearly abusing your power. How do I, you know, work with you but still keep my dignity?
Comply and fight later. My thing is, listen, let me comply. Let me, quote unquote, submit or surrender to authority. Right?
Right?
Take me to jail. Lock me up, and then let's deal with this legally. But I'm not going to create a scene which could lead to the loss of my life in the middle of the street or later in a jail cell. And I just think that we have to stop making the same mistakes again and again and again and again and again. I think no matter what side of the fence you're on, we all left, or most people left watching this story with the wrong lesson. The lesson that should be learned in this scenario is, keep your cool. Maintain a positive attitude. Comply with the officer. Now, we know that there have been several individuals that have complied and have still lost
right.
their life.
That's true.
But your chances are better complying than not complying.
Right. The odds are that you would come out of it safely than the odds are that you won't. And that makes complete sense. I like what you're saying. Use common sense. Maintain your coolness. Realize that you have remedies that may not exist at that moment, but can exist later, and you can take those up after you get to a safe place. Another thing is, if you had another person with you, you probably would have a little bit more leverage because you have another witness. Clearly, there was no other witness other than the camera, which, funny enough, at some point in time, it seems, was taken off or was edited or something.
Yeah, that was from the car.
Right, exactly.
That's even weird to me, because I'm watching the video at first and I'm watching, listening, I don't hear no sound. Or I don't see anything. And I'm like, what's going on? So, you know, that is fishy.
But you know, I think it's important that we realize who we're dealing with. In my studies, I've come to the conclusion that there are two different types of police officers we're dealing with. And when I say two different types, I'm not meaning good cop versus bad cop. But I mean, you have militarized police officers, those who have come out of the Marines, the Army, the Air Force, you know, the Navy. And now, you know, once they become, quote-unquote, civilians, they enter into law enforcement because it's a nice transition for them.
Right.
And so they're trained militarily. So these are individuals that are trained in guerrilla warfare. They're trained in domestic terrorism. They're trained in how to go into neighborhoods and black boots, stomp someone's door down, and get everybody to surrender. That's what they do. They do this all over the world.
Right.
And then you have people who go through the police academy that have a completely different training. And I can say in my own personal experience, I have witnessed both the militarized police officer and the police academy police officer. Their disposition is completely different. The level of friendliness, if you will, is completely different. Some of them are just cold, callous, emotionless, and they're just zombies. And no matter what you say, there's no reasoning with them. So to become belligerent in that type of situation is not going to be in your best benefit.
That's absolutely true. That's very good. Very good point. We have a caller on the line, so we want to bring in our caller. Valroy, are you there? Valroy? Okay, did we lose him? All right, Valroy, if you're listening, then you can call back, because I think he wanted to chime in. So let's keep going. Okay, so we know about that particular situation. There's another situation, I don't know if you guys had heard about, where the young guy was apprehended and was taken to jail and put into a van. And when he was put into the van, I couldn't believe this, they shackled him, his hands and everything, put him in the van, and then started to drive the van recklessly so that he ended up snapping his neck,
whoa,
which led to his death. So, you know, the conflict, I guess he was also expressing himself that they didn't have a right to arrest him. He didn't do anything. And when they arrested him, they put him in that van, but they tied his hands and his legs. So when they, you know, if you imagine being in one of these police vans, it's nothing but steel interior walls. So he's laying on the floor with his hands and his feet shackled.
Mm-hmm.
And then they drive recklessly, moving him from place to place in the van, and he ends up dying as a result of the trauma. And they said, you know, he was in the van and he must have hit something on accident and he died. So, you know, these situations where, you know, like you said, it's all about how you go into them, you know, getting yourself to a safe place and resolving conflict appropriately. I think, Hassani, though, in conflict, we must have to identify that sometimes you're just totally caught off guard. How do you deal with that pressure in that one moment? I know you say maintain your coolness, but at that moment, you know, everybody's adrenaline is moving and everything's pumping and people are just upset. I mean, how do you handle that?
You know what, to your point, the fact is you're right. Many of us are caught off guard, but in the state that we're living in America, we have to almost prepare, right? We have to be on guard for any situation that can occur. Every time I get in my car and I leave my house and go across the street to the grocery store or around the corner to the gym, I've got to be prepared for any situation. You know, it's so interestingly, in the book I wrote, Pimping from the Pulpit to the Pews, Exposing and Expelling the Spirit of Lust in the Church, I talk about how you have to almost rehearse the consequences of sexual sin. So if I perform this act, what could possibly happen as a result of doing wrong, right? What's the parallel? What's the point I'm making? Every time I leave my house, I have to think, what would happen if I got pulled over by the cops? Do I have the proper paperwork? You know, do I have my seatbelt on? How am I dressed? How am I looking? As a black man in America, it's unfortunate that I have to have those conversations with myself. And so I have to, rehearse in my mind how something may play out because I've been in too many situations. So at this point, I think it's important that we prepare for anything. And at the same time, when we get caught up in these situations, rather than becoming emotional, we have to begin to ask questions for clarity. Officer, was there anything that I did wrong? I think it's all about our tone, our disposition, and our ability to ask questions as opposed to making assumptions and becoming confrontational with the officer.
I like that.
So what do you do, Hassani, when the officer doesn't want to answer the question? You notice that a lot of videos that we see, there's an officer pulls somebody over. They ask a lot of questions. They want answers to their questions. But when the civilian asks a question, it's either avoided or it's skated around or it's totally ignored. So how do you handle that? How do you suggest handling that?
Well, all I can do is speak. Listen, I'm not trained and skilled on how to handle these situations. I just know what I have done. You know, in those situations, I talk very little. I answer very quickly, but I keep a smile on my face. I have a pleasant disposition. And before that officer walks up to my window, when the officer walks back and then walks up to my window again, I'm in prayer. I'm doing everything. I have my phone on speaker for my wife to hear every single word in our dialogue. I make sure that my hands are on the steering wheel at the 9 o'clock position, at the 3 o'clock position. I make sure that the paperwork is ready to go. I make sure that I over-explain where I am, where I'm going, what I'm doing, because I want to go home to my wife and my 4 children. Now, is any of that necessary? No. Do I have to do that? No. But am I willing to go above and beyond the call of duty to make sure that I walk away or drive away? Absolutely, yes.
Yeah.
I just heard about someone. They got pulled over. They decided they called 911 just to say, hey, I'm being pulled over. I'm in this area. So when the police officer approached, they were like, I just want you to know I'm on the phone now with 911. They said that police officer's disposition changed immediately. So
that's good.
Wow.
You may need
Love
to identify
it.
That you have a witness. That you have someone listening, which is, you know, when you do have someone listening, it becomes more legal when you do let the person know that they are being, you know, monitored.
Right, because 911 is recording.
Because I was going to say, I mean, that for some police officers, that could even upset some police officers, you know, that maybe not the 911, well, anybody, you know, let's say, you know, Hassani's wife, oh, well, you're going to have somebody, you know, so they may decide to cut the phone off and no one's recording, you know, but with a legal entity like the 911, if it cuts off, then they automatically know, something went wrong.
Right.
So I think, I kind of think that's really smart.
I think it's smart too. And go ahead, Hassani.
I was going to say, you know, I remember, I don't know if I shared this story before, but I remember driving through Kentucky And for some reason, I think I switched lanes, or maybe my speed was a little bit fast or whatever. I get pulled over by the police, and the police officer takes me out of my car, brings out the canine dog, circles the car several times,
wow.
has me sitting on side for like 30 minutes. And I'm like, is all of this necessary? Like, do I fit a description or something? And he's just like, you'd be surprised. We've had 70-year-old white women sneaking pounds and pounds of cocaine through the state border. So there is no fitting the description. It could be anyone. And so a lot of times they're on guard, they're apprehensive, they're cautious. My wife's been stopped several times, and they have asked her, do you have any weapons on you? And she was just like, do I have any weapons? Of course not. Mm-hmm. Well, we've had several women that have pulled weapons out on us. We've been sabotaged by several people. So they're on guard as well, and so we have to, it seems like we have to over-accommodate what they may be going through by making sure that we're non-threatening.
That's true. And the other thing I think that it's important for us to realize is that it's important for us to know our rights. I mean, a lot of people don't know, you know, that really he should have given her a search warrant before he searched her car. Yeah. He was all in her car. So just a simple fact, let's say if it's being videotaped and you say, do you have a search warrant or officer? You know, another thing you can do is you can ask for their superior to come on the scene if you feel uncomfortable. Right. I feel uncomfortable. Can you call the watch commander? Whatever it is, these things you should know, because knowledge is power. And
that's
to not know your rights, you get into situations that lawyers later can't even get you out of. You know, it's very helpful if you're going to challenge them in some shape, form, or fashion, that you make them stay as close to what is legal than not. Because if not, you can jeopardize your case.
And you know what? On that note, let me just say, I saw a guy who was in Baltimore in his car. He had all types of cameras in his car. He's recording his conversation as he's being pulled over by the police, and literally he knew every law. He knew more about the law than a police officer did, and literally punked the cop. Now, he was not disrespectful. He was not angry and arrogant, but he was knowledgeable, and it worked. So your point is correct, absolutely correct, Raquel.
Yes.
I agree with that, Raquel, and what you said, and Hassani, what you said. But for those listening, I want to make sure, too, Sandra, she knew her certain rights, but also the police was like, I don't care. He didn't say that, but in a sense, his action said, I don't care. He felt like what he said is law, period.
But now, was she asserting her rights? I don't know if she was asserting her rights.
I mean, she was saying, legally, you don't have a right to tell me to put out my cigarette or do this and that. Why am I being arrested? You know, because it went from, give me my ticket to, okay, now get out the car, you're being arrested. She's like, for what? So she knew her rights in some way, but he just didn't care. So I understand what you guys are saying,
right.
And I agree, you should know your rights, but also understand just because you know your rights doesn't mean the police officer is going to let you assert those.
Right.
So be careful.
But you're right, and I think if we take a one-dimensional approach, if we isolate every one of these skill sets, maybe they don't work. But when you pull them all together
yeah.
knowing your rights, having the right disposition,
being cool,
you know, being pleasing in your presentation and your personality, all of those things combined can create a better scenario.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. So in other words, if she would have said, you know, officer, with all due respect, you know, I smoke because this is what I do. Do you have a problem with it? Is there something I should be, you know, is there something I should know, you know, or because my understanding is I'm able to smoke, you
right.
know. You know.
Right.
So that's different than, you can't tell me what to do, and I can smoke a cigarette if I want to. However that went, you know, and hey, we're not blaming, like you said earlier,
right.
Anthony, because at that time, it's a very, very pressure time, and so you may say and do anything. So we can't judge.
And you know what? I don't want anybody listening to the show to think that we're, you know, in essence, pointing the finger at her and saying she's the reason why she's dead. That's ridiculous.
Right.
The cop was wrong as two left shoes.
But
we're saying when we know the cop is wrong, what do we do to get out of the situation? I mean, from the time that she got thrown down to the ground and possibly broke her shoulder to the 3 days that she was in prison. Now, listen, we know what we saw in that video. I can almost guarantee that she was no different in that jail cell. Could you imagine 3 days of her and her, you know, her screaming, her yelling, her antagonizing police? I'm sure she did it because she did it in the video.
Right.
Does that justify her murder? No, it doesn't. But what we're saying is do the best you can do. We could talk all day about what the police needs to do, what the legal system needs to do, what laws need to be changed, but you're relying on someone else to take your advice. All we can control is us and what we do.
I think, too, you know, how Hassani in the beginning was talking about a power complex that officers have. And I think sometimes we as citizens, and I'm even, you know, guilty of it, not just with officers, but in general, we have this ego complex, you know, where we are in situations and we don't like to be disrespected or we don't like to be talked down to or treated like, you know, treated a certain way. So we feel that we have to, you know, not back down because you're not going to talk to me like that. And so it comes down to a point of is my, in this moment, like Hassani said, you know, is my ego and how I feel about this person talking to me bigger than my life? Like this situation is only 30 seconds, 30 minutes, an hour, whatever, but my life is years. So am I willing to let my ego and my pride aside to jeopardize, you know, would I let it jeopardize the rest of my life? And so, you know, understanding that it's a bigger picture than just this moment here.
Right. And I think we always, for some reason in conflict, we always concentrate on the moment, not realizing what the repercussions are. And that's important to remember in conflict, is to think about it. In this moment, whatever you do in this moment. I was reading an article, and a friend had told me about this guy. He was a pastor at one point. He was a pretty upstanding citizen. And he ended up falling into drug abuse, probably because of, you know, past issues and problems that he couldn't get over. And of course, he got into drug abuse. He ended up being in his house having a drug party with a couple people. And when he woke up from the drug stupor, he hallucinated that these two women that had been with him the whole time were like undercover cops, and he shot them and killed them.
Wow.
And so I thought about this, Hassani. I thought, you know, it's amazing, because in that one moment in time, in conflict, in some serious situation where your emotions are heightened, you can make a decision that can change your very life. Now he is a former pastor looking at double murder.
Wow.
All because, and drugs, we know, can change your mood, not only can change your mood, but can alter you psychologically. So for that moment, he was out having an out-of-body experience, but he committed two murders. And he has to, you know, now he has to go through that whole process and most likely will lose the rest of his life. So when you talk about conflict and you talk about conflict resolution and conflict management, it's important that we learn how to handle ourselves in these situations, because some of us get off light by telling somebody off and, you know, that's the end of it. Some of us get into altercations where somebody's injured, and then some of us get so far to where someone dies. So, you know, we have to know, you know, how to fold them.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I was going to say, and what's so sad is that we have to play by different rules. We know that there's a double standard in this country, because the same law that is applied to us, a lot of other people are given a pass. Like the video that we were all watching a day or so ago of the white woman, the young white woman who's in her car, and the white police officer approach. And you, I mean, could you come up with a better example of disrespect?
Right.
She was so disrespectful to this police officer and punked the cop.
Punked him.
Mm-hmm. And the cop did absolutely nothing.
We're talking about the one where she told the officer to take off her glasses, take off his sunglasses. Mm-hmm. She felt threatened by him having his sunglasses on.
And then he said that he couldn't see because the sun was so bright. And she said, I'm not talking to you until you take off your sunglasses.
I was like,
thank you, officer. Go back to your car now, officer. And I'm like, am I watching a skit on SNL or something that did not make the cut? Like, what is this that I'm watching? It was crazy.
This is true. This is so true. So, you know, I guess conflict does have some bearing on who you are. You know, whether, you know, what position you're in the conflict, who you could be culturally or ethnically could have a bias. So you have to, all these things you have to take into consideration. Yes, Anthony.
So we've been talking about conflict in terms of law enforcement, but what about those everyday
people. Right, I was going to just bring that up about about relationships, like for instance, marriage. You know, you have those situations where you know one or the other takes a position and feels very, very strongly about it, and the other person, you know, of course, is on the opposite end of it, Hassani, and it gets to a point where you can't move forward. You don't want to be around the person. You don't want to talk to the person anymore. If you're in a marital situation, sometimes you even want to get out of the marriage. And so when you're in those very, very emotional situations, what's the best thing to do to get yourself to a point where you can communicate and get to a resolution?
Unfortunately, I deal with this all the time because I deal with a lot of couples who are experiencing infidelity, right? So,
of
course, there's going to be conflict. So I tell people all the time, you have to have rules of engagement. See, communication is probably the biggest issue couples struggle with, no matter what it is. But when you're dealing with, like, infidelity and betrayal, it's something crazy. So you're like on an emotional roller coaster, right? It's very volatile. And when you express your feelings, a lot of times it comes out in disgust and just straight hatred. And couples go to war with each other. So to me, there are rules of engagement that you've got to follow, rules that you've got to live by to govern the conversation. Now, if you throw these rules out, then you know what? Then you're going to be in for a ride that you may not be ready for. But if you obey them, it can work out. Now, one of the rules of engagement is the proper time and the proper place. Not every conversation is worth having at certain times. Like, I know couples literally, I just got off the phone with a gentleman today right before this call. About 3-4 days a week, his wife will literally wake him up at 3 o'clock in the morning to have a conversation.
Why is that?
Because she feels like it. That's why.
Oh, okay. Just to annoy him, not because that's the proper time.
Exactly. Okay. He could be on his way to work. He could be in a business meeting, and she will call. And if he doesn't answer, now you don't love me, you don't care about me, your job is more important to me. So what I'm saying is, a lot of times you bring your emotion into the situation, which does not help. When you're emotionally led in a situation, it will always go south. That's why you need the perfect balance between logic, come on, where your reasoning is, and your emotion, balancing the two in order to deal with something effectively. A lot of times people call each other out of their name all the time. Now, it's going to result in conflict. You know, I can go on and on and on. I don't want to consume the conversation, but I'm ultimately saying, if you are led by your emotions, it's going to be a horrific scenario. And a lot of times people make rash decisions that impact the rest of their lives because of a moment of emotional weakness.
Okay, so I'm listening to you and I'm thinking, well, women are emotional. That's one of our basic needs is to emotionally attach ourselves in a relationship. So are you saying, yeah, but you need to control that? I mean, you can be emotional, and that could be one of your basic needs, and it can be fed. But at a certain point in time, even women can control their emotions. Is what you're saying?
What I'm saying is this. A grape can be used for medicinal purposes. A grape can be used for its nutritional value. But that same grape, given a certain spin, given a certain twist, can be used to do great harm. Not what you use, but how you use what you use, and not where you get it from, but what you do with it once you get it. What's the point? Emotions could be good and bad. It's all about how you manage your emotions. Listen, men are emotional too. Women are emotional, and both of us act out negatively and positively. So it's all about managing your emotions, you know, at certain times, and knowing how to have a solution-oriented conversation that results in us moving forward. Even if you're failing forward, inching forward, at least you're moving in the right direction. But if I'm just trying to fight for the sake of fighting, if I am so committed to being right, we both lose. See, if I'm right, it means you're wrong. But if I'm willing to give up the right to be right, that means there's a possibility that we both can win.
So, lovely. Hassani, how do you shift that to a coworker, to a boss, to someone who, I ain't got to go home with you. I ain't even got to talk to you in the office. You know, I'm here to do my job. And let's say I need something from them, or we got to work as a team, but they like, hey, I can get my job done without having to really interact with you. You need me more than I need you.
I think it's important to know the proper protocol and procedure on your particular job to know when there is a conflict or when there is a personality difference between two coworkers, whether you be on the same level or even if it's your supervisor. You have to go back to that handbook, figure out what the handbook says is necessary to resolve the conflict. Make sure you're not operating in emotions, and you do that, and assuming that that will work. If that doesn't work, then you have to figure out what the next step is. But yeah, you have to go back to the foundational principles that govern order in that particular work environment.
I know from being in corporate, document everything.
That's true. Document everything. Documentation is important.
You want to put stuff, make sure things are in writing and you have things laid
out. And you know something to add to the documentation? If you're going to document, make sure that you put it in something that you keep. Because a lot of people document things in company-owned email systems or computer systems, and the first thing they take is their stuff. So all your documentation goes along with it.
Right.
So that's just a word to the wise. Charity, you have anything to add?
No, I mean, Hassani, can you touch on a little bit more about the marriage negotiation? When we were at the marriage encounter, you did marriage negotiation, and it was like mind opening in terms of how to. And I feel like what you described was way beyond just marriage. But
that's
I think
at Crenshaw Christian Center.
At Crenshaw Christian Center, yes, and that can be for every type of relationship with parents, with friends. I think this negotiation tactic can be helpful for a lot of people.
Thank you so much, because I have to give all the attendees there some things that I had promised them, so thanks for reminding me. But in essence, the marriage negotiation worksheet is not just for marriages in any scenario, but ultimately, when you're thinking about negotiation, first of all, I hate the word compromise. Compromise implies someone wins, someone loses. So if I'm in a work relationship, romantic relationship, and I believe that I've got to compromise, and that's the nature that I take in our relationship, I'm always losing in order for you to win. I've always lose that you may gain. Over the course of time, that's going to create a very huge problem, because if I'm in a marital relationship and I keep on sacrificing and compromising for the sake of my wife, at some point I'm going to go rogue. Because I'm going to get to the point where I'm not taking this anymore. I've done it for years. I'm sick and tired. You, on the other hand, the one who wins, feels like a mutiny has just taken place.
Right.
And I'm overthrowing some government because, well, why now are you complaining? It's always been this way because I've suffered in silence. Negotiation is not win-lose. It is win-win. Think about a business negotiation. You constantly go back and forth for hours and hours and hours until you come up with something that's mutually beneficial. So the policy of joint agreement says we both may have to give up certain things in this negotiation, but at the end of the day, we both win because our voices are heard, our interests are represented, we both come out on top. So there are literally four steps that I take couples through or anyone through to resolve conflict to make sure that they have solution-oriented conversations that result in change and transformation in their particular situation and resolves conflict every single time.
Can you give us the four?
Number one, you have to write down what the issue is. A lot of times people fight, and then at the end of the day, they're not even fighting about the same thing.
Yeah.
I'm talking about apples, you're talking about oranges. So on this document, you have to write down, number one, what the issue is. Number two, you have to write down what your perspective on the issue is, and then you write down your partner's perspective. You want to be able to see things from all sides, right?
Right.
Number three, then you write down the possible solutions that you've come up with to resolve this particular issue, right? Mm-hmm. So you're doing this separately from your partner, individually, writing it down on paper. Then you come together and discuss, number one, the problem, number two, perspectives, number three, solutions. Now, once you've had that conversation, you now have a number of solutions you both come up with. Then you need to negotiate based upon all these solutions which ones you're going to implement to see if this issue can be resolved. And you'll go back and forth trying a few different solutions till you find something that works. Now, when you do this, it always works. Couples who throw away the tool and say, I don't need this darn tool. We can figure this out ourselves. What happens is these are hot-button conversations. Emotion takes over. I don't like the way you said what you said, and now we're in deep conflict. Those who operate according to the tool, it works. And so I love using this tool because I see total transformation in people's lives and in their relationship.
So you make them go through the steps. You make them think about the steps, both individually and together, and then implement whatever solutions they've come up with as a result of thinking this through. So,
yes, ma'am.
So so that's good. It creates a team.
Yes.
It really creates, working together. Charity.
I think, too, we've been talking about, or we as in the young adults, Turning Point at Crenshaw Christian Center, have been talking a lot about just a lot of different things, relationships, and we've said, I think a big part of conflict is a lack of communication and understanding that in a relationship, each person has been brought up differently. Like, unless you guys have the same parents, one, I hope you guys would not be dating. But each person has been brought up differently. And so one may have a notion of how things should be or how they should do things because that's what they've been taught. And the other person has something completely different. And so when you don't communicate, you're upset at the guy because he didn't do this. But yet in his mind, he's thinking he's doing everything right. But he doesn't know you're mad because that's not how you were raised. And then he's mad at you because you're not doing what he thinks a woman should do, but there was no one in your family, a woman in your family who did that. So to you, you're like, well, why should I do that? And no one's talking, and so people's feelings get hurt, and people get automatically X'd out because no one's talking. So I think being really transparent and being open could probably limit a lot of conflict before it even gets to conflict.
No, I really like that. And I have a comment. I'll let Anthony go ahead and make his comment.
Okay. I actually have a question for Hassani. You've been addressing dealing with people who are, let's say, quote unquote, rational. But what happens when you have a family member, a coworker who you know is on a substance, weed, some other illegal, well, weed is not illegal, depending on where you, but some other substance that you're like, they're not thinking straight. That drug they're taking is making them think this way. How do you deal with that? How do you rationalize?
It's so interesting you say drug, right? Because interestingly enough, we are addicted to our emotions, and our emotions oftentimes act as a drug, which makes us irrational. You've got to know when to hold them and when to fold them, right? So in essence, if you're in a conversation and it seems to be getting too emotional and there's no logic and reason involved, that's when you have to bow out. Maybe you need to take a break. Maybe you need to settle down, calm down, come back and have this conversation again. If you realize, second time, third time, fourth time, it's just not working, that's when you want to bring in an intermediary. Sometimes it's good to have somebody that can balance the perspectives. And this is why we say it's always good to submit to another authority who has wisdom that you may not have. Because even if they're emotional and you're logical, that doesn't mean you're right because you're logical. So when you both take your grievance to someone else that can help sort it out for you, then I think that you could possibly get a better result than if you were to do it on your own.
Yeah, yeah. And that's good. I like how you say bringing it, because a lot of people don't realize that bringing in someone who has a little bit more wisdom in a situation than you, or someone who is emotionally more stable than you at the time, can really, really benefit you in conflict resolution. Let's say even in, situations at work. If there is, your boss always has a boss. So if you need to pull in someone and say, I'm having difficulty, can you help us, manage our relationship? Or if, in a marital situation, a counselor or a pastor, or it could be, a parent who has great wisdom who could say, I'm seeing this from another vantage point and let me tell you what I'm seeing. And that could kind of pop your view open. But don't you think, Hassani, that you have to be, no matter whether the person's, emotionally deranged or on some type of substance, you have to be a person who's at least willing to want to salvage the relationship. Because if you're not willing to want to salvage a relationship, do you think that you can manage conflict that well? I mean, if you're not willing or you don't care about salvaging whatever position you have in the relationship?
No, because you've already checked out. You may physically be there, but you're already gone. There's a couple right now that came to me for counsel. Well, actually, the husband did. And the woman checked out, like, weeks ago. And he's fighting and doing all he can, and she's just like, and next, and so what? No, not hearing it. I'm out. So no matter what he's doing, and we're praying and hoping, and I'm working with him, but you do have to have a level of interest. That's why I always say the person who is the person who's more emotionally committed to the relationship has the least power in it. Now, that's a deep statement.
That is
it's
deep.
So true.
Say that one more time.
The person who's the most emotionally committed to the relationship has the least power in it.
Wow. So what do you, okay, so if you are that person, what do you do?
you know, that's where that whole concept, and many of us have seen the movie, I think it's, what is it, Fireproof?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Which is based upon the book The Dare, and it talks about, listen, because Danielle was in that place. She had checked out. She was done. She was over. She was kaput. We were just living together. We were roommates.
Right.
And I had to be consistent in my effort. It wasn't about a one-time, you know, gesture. It wasn't about
inconsistent.
Yeah, yeah, it was about consistency. And I had to prove to her, you know, my commitment, my love. And eventually she came around. So, listen, sometimes all it takes is one person to fight to change the situation around. And eventually that other person will get on board. But you've got to be willing to have the ability to suffer long and to have longevity and to be willing to fail again and again and again and again until you ultimately get it right. And I was willing to do that. I was willing to fail more than anyone else, and that's why I still have my marriage today.
Lovely. So, okay, so the couple you're counseling, you're saying if people are listening to us and they're thinking about conflicts in their personal life, that there really is no position of failure if you are determined to put the time in and put the work in.
You got to put it in. You have to be long-suffering. You have to have patience. You have to exhibit the fruit of
the Spirit.
We always
yes.
talk about the gifts, but don't talk about the fruit.
Yes. That's so true. And those are what? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness.
Yes. And if we had that in our interaction with the police, if we had that in our interaction with the coworker, if we had that in our interaction with our spouse, I guarantee you they may not always go right, but more often than not, they will.
Lovely. And, you know, it goes back to, you know, love never fails, you know, that love changes things. I mean, you know, if we, you know, what's that song? What the world needs now is love, sweet love.
Yes.
You know, I'm glad you're saying it.
Yeah, I was gonna, you know, whatever, Charity. I was gonna sing it, but I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want Quincy Jones to try to call up and give me a contract right now because I'm busy, Quincy. I'm busy. But yeah, I like that song because it's so true. I mean, if you think about the things we're going through in the world now, even, you know, you have people, you know, terrorist activities where people are killing people, murdering people over religious disputes. If we just had love, Hassani, a lot of our conflicts, even our worldwide conflicts, would be resolved or at least communicated and worked out.
And you know what? The type of love that we need is the love that's exhibited when we tap into the Spirit, when we operate according to our higher nature, not our lower nature. There's so many dark, evil, malicious, diabolical, sinister, wicked people in this world, whether they're conscious of it or not, and they have base emotions that govern their lives. And when they begin to tap into the Spirit of God that exists within them and they begin to exhibit that love, we will see a completely different world all around us.
And how can we get people to realize that? I mean, because everybody's understanding of love is so different. But, you know, I just think about people. You know, you can have the kind of, one time I was in line at McDonald's. And I didn't have that much time. Normally, I don't eat at McDonald's, so don't get excited. But I was getting a little Happy Meal, and I'm in the back of the car that's at the window pane.
Right.
And when I get to, there's two windows. There's a window you pay, and then there's a window you pick up the food.
Yeah.
I'm at the window you pay, and there's somebody at the window picking up their food. And the window, when I got to the window to pay, the man said, "Oh, the lady in front of you took care of your meal."
Wow.
And I said, it's those precious moments when you realize this was a Caucasian woman who didn't know me from anywhere. I was in the valley, which we're you know, in a familiar area for myself. But I just said, you know what? These are moments when you feel like, guess what? There are people out there who know about love. And so I would encourage you, now that we've been talking about conflict resolution, is to really let's practice using love as a part of our solution for conflict resolution. Let's maintain our coolness. Let's think before we make decisions. Let's realize that every choice that we make has a repercussion. And if you want a good outcome, then make a good choice. And, you know, the other thing is, do something good for somebody. It makes you feel good.
It can be so small. It can be so random. I heard about a story where somebody, you know, the red boxes, you have to turn the DVD back
yes,
into the
Yes, absolutely.
Thing. In the red box was $4 and a note, and it said, "Buy yourself some movie treats on me." Little stuff. Like, you know, people think that in order for me to make a difference,
you have to have a lot of money.
I have to have a lot of money. It has to be catastrophic. People have to see me. And it really doesn't have to be all that. Like, you can trust me. Whatever you have in your hand right now, I guarantee you somebody could be blessed by it.
And somebody needs it.
You know, every day on my timeline, on my Facebook page, I'm seeing a video of an officer or somebody kind of getting into a conflict with somebody. And I'm a little concerned. I respect officers. I mean, people in military. Don't ask me to go. I would go, but don't ask me to go, because I really respect what they do and put themselves out there. But I'm wondering, are we as a society, because I'm seeing these videos, I'm like, I was actually online looking at those webcams you put on your car. I'm like,
right.
Are we getting desensitized? Are we kind of looking at them as the enemy when they're really there to protect and serve? I mean, if something goes down in my place, I'm calling. I'm like, 911, get somebody over here, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the internet has a twofold effect. I mean, it gives you information, but it also creates an anxiety about situations that don't necessarily need to be there.
I never felt that way about police officers. Yeah. I mean, my interaction has been mostly good. So, but now that I'm seeing more negative things, I'm like, okay, it's getting me thinking. And I have a feeling I'd be more nervous if I got pulled over than I would be in any time.
Hassani, do you want to comment on that?
I mean, I feel you. I mean, I've had my own individual experiences with police officers that were both favorable and unfavorable. I will say, seeing as much as I'm seeing, you know, on Facebook and other social media platforms, raises my awareness and consciousness. But listen, if I never saw a video, I do get nervous every time I get pulled over. And that's why I enter into the heavenlies and allow the angels to come down and do what they need to do while I do what I need to do. And so as a result of that, I'm still breathing, walking, talking today. And so, you know, that's the best advice that I could ever give somebody. Your relationship with God and divine protection from those that have ill will, you know, towards you.
That is so true. That is so true. So we encourage you here at the Naked Truth for this week to do a good deed for somebody. There will be an opportunity for you to handle conflict this week. Guarantee you. It'll be something. It could be, you know, a dispute you have a coworker. It could be somebody in the street that you feel, you know, they've just, you know, jumped in front of me in my car. And I feel like, you know, honking them out or telling them off or whatever.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Can we address this really quick?
Yes.
I have a not so, I don't want to say a special relationship with my horn, but I have a familiar relationship with my horn.
Wow.
But what I'm saying is, you know, when I do honk and people say, well, you shouldn't honk at people because you never, you know, but I feel like there are times when you are alerting someone of what they're doing by honking. You know what I'm saying? I'm not honking at you because I want you to get out of my way. I'm honking because if I don't honk at you, you may actually hit me. So I need to...
Well, you know, and I think people, when you honk to get people's attention, I think they kind of feel that, like, oh, my bad, sorry. But, you know, there is honking where you're talking, going, move out of my way, you moron. So it just depends on...
On the honking.
On the honking.
So maybe, you know, like a 1-2
Yeah, like
honk.
A quick honk.
Not like a...
Right.
Okay.
Right. And don't add verbal stuff with it. Yeah. And don't have that face.
I'm sure your window should be up if you are having
verbal. This is true. This is true.
I just want
honk
to make
and smile.
Sure.
That's good.
Okay.
See, it's all about attitude.
I
honk and just
sure.
smile. That'll work. Try that. Okay.
Is that like when the police officer pulls you over and they smiling and you like, no, come on, this ticket ain't nothing to smile about.
Yeah.
Really?
And yeah, you
honk
know.
And smile.
But see, you know, well, no. Women, well, anyway.
Oh, yeah, but if Charity smiles, I'll be like,
yeah, that's
okay.
What I was going to say.
I'm
see,
like, I'm good with that. I'm
smiling
like,
is not a bad
put
idea.
Put the camera back on Charity. Yeah. See what,
now,
see,
women,
she's smiling.
You know, you probably should use your smile on when a police officer comes, because I'm pretty sure 90% of the time it will work.
It will work.
You know, smile.
I mean, most women have
How's
gotten out
day?
Of a ticket because of their smile or something.
You know.
Something.
Really, you know.
Yeah.
Use what God gave you.
Yeah. Use it.
Use it.
All
can
right.
Save your life.
Don't forget, it is not your abilities that reveal your true strengths. It's your choices. Thank you, Hassani. Good night.
Thank you.
You can say what you want to say, be who you want to be, come speak your